Donna, so much for always, always such beautiful music that you play. We appreciate you in everything you do for us. Thank you so much. Thank you as well, Keith. You know, we're blessed by the people that take the time for us to come and share and worship with us. We're so blessed that we have such a group of God-loving, God-fearing people. Thank you as well, Lon, for that are willing to come and share their time with us, right? Share their fellowship with us. We should all be thankful for that and keep them in our prayers. It's truly, you know, not everybody's willing to do it. And it's truly a blessing when someone takes the time to do works like this that are, you know, not easy. This isn't easy. This is an out of the way thing to do for people, right? But we thank them all. Thank you all for being here. Nice to see a good crowd again, continuing to grow and all that. And we will get to a point, I'm sure, where we'll run out of seats. And as I told you, when we do, I'll bring in more seats. So no worries at that at all. But I'm glad to see everybody here. Glad to continue to see beautiful faces and wonderful friends and family. We do have a wonderful service plan today. Of course, we're going to be doing communion today. And as I have mentioned to you a couple weeks ago, you know, it's a choice. It's something that if you're not ready to do, if it's not something that you feel comfortable doing, I'd rather you not partake, okay? If you don't feel you are ready for that, or if there's something in your life right now that prevents you from taking communion, the Bible clearly tells us that we should just abstain that day. And that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. I'd rather you not put yourself in a position where you are not following God's rules, God's laws, God's commandments, right? Don't let anyone else tell you what God has already told you. You do what is right for you and God, okay? So certainly that is something that we'll be doing today, and of course it's a blessing. Anytime we have an opportunity to come together as believers in God and share in communion with fellow saints, that's a blessing. And as He tells us in His Word, we should do it, you know, always. We should do it all often. It doesn't have to just be at church. You can do it yourself at home. Simply bread and a little bit of juice is all you need, and an open heart and love for God. So we'll be getting started today. I'm going to turn things over to Mr. Keith after I say a quick prayer for us to begin, and then we will we'll get going and do our normal service. We'll wait till the end of service to do communion. So certainly, if you're not wanting to stick around for that, feel free to leave at that point. If you do want to stay around, certainly do, and we'll get started with it about 2 minutes after our normal services end. We'll begin the communion. That'll give you an opportunity. If you're not prepared, you can leave at that point. All right, everybody, bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, Lord, as your humble servants, Father. We thank you for another opportunity, Lord, to share your fellowship with brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, I thank you so much, Lord, so much for bringing me to this congregation. Father, I thank you for the privilege and the honor it's been to serve you and serve you in front of fellow Christians. Father, thank you for that. Thank you, Lord, for preparing me for further service to you, Father. Thank you for the opportunity to share and your blessings with my fellow Christians. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity to learn more about you and grow and become a better Christian each and every time I hear your word. Father, I ask that everyone's heart be open today, our minds be open today to hear the message from Lon, that we might learn from it, that we might be edified by it, that it might bring us closer to sanctification and closer to justification to you. Father, we thank you that you give us that opportunity to grow in grace each day, to grow in your love each day. And that, Father, we know on the last day that when you return, those of us that are true believers in you, that you have already made a place for us, Father, that there is a place in heaven for each and every one of us that believes in you. Father, I ask that this service honor you, that we would all lift our hearts to you, give our all to you, and that, Father, each and every one of us would leave here today and be obedient servants to your will and your love. Father, we thank you for all that you do each and every day in our lives. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, in our Savior's name, our Messiah's name, our Lord, our God's name we pray. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Awesome, guys. So I'm going to turn it over to Keith, and he's going to sing some beautiful songs for us.
All right. Well, listen, I want you to know, sometimes I have to sneak out. It's not because I don't like you. I promise you that. I have my choir practice on Sundays, and so it's funny. I showed up the other week, and I had to pick up somebody from choir practice, and the bunch of them sitting in the parking lot. Wait a minute. I'm like, you got to give me time. So anyway, we're going to do a happy clappy song. Take your hymn book. Turn to hymn 601. I'll Fly Away. Let's sing out. And 601, we'll sing all three of them. Let's sing. Come back, Lord, we can fly before. By rote, what they hear, and then they put it all together, and you know, they go from there. And then when they publish new music, this is really interesting too, they publish to a company called Word Music. They would send the recordings to Word Music, and then they would just put the parts and write them down so other churches who had the people who read the music, they would look at it. But anyway, but when they do all that, those things, and again, another thing with this Brooklyn Tap, they have no bass part. So if you're a bass, too bad, because they sing everything high. Everything high. But anyway, this song she wrote is called He's Been Faithful. And I want to tell you, there is nothing like, I know I'm still young, but I'm not young. I mean, I'm still young, but not super old yet, but not super young. I'm 53, so I guess midway there. And probably I'll still live more years than what I'm going to live out. Unless God keeps me to 106. I doubt that. But anyway, but I've seen how God has been so faithful all through my life. And one of the things that my wife and I have done in our life, early in life, we see little things, you know, where God came through, you know, where that money, extra money came in to help us pay a bill, or that extra money for us to get tires, or, you know, just these different things. And we look back on those times when another time comes up and goes, I'll say, Tim, you remember that altar back there, what Christ did, what He did for us? He's going to do it again. He's going to do the same thing. Amen. And I think that's what we need to do. That's why the altars were built in the Bible. I may have said this, but the Bible, when they would go to place, something would happen at this place. The Israelites would build an altar. Part of that, obviously, the altar was to worship God and to show their worship to Him and their thankfulness. But also, as it says in God's Word, it says your children and grandchildren, you come back and say, you see that altar right there?
Yes.
That's what God did. This is what happened here.
Amen.
And it reminds them of God's faithfulness.
Yes.
But I want you just to listen to this song. I love this song. And it's called He's Been Faithful. Even when I'm unfaithful, He's faithful.
Yes.
This is what this song minister to you.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
favorite hymns ever. I love the hymns. Turn to hymn 96. Great is thy faithfulness. Let's turn to hymn 96. And let's sing them all three verses of that too. Hymn 96.
Because that's what Jesus wants us to do.
Yeah.
To live through us, to be an encouragement to you. And I pray that whenever we come here to worship with you, you are excited, expecting something. Amen? That God will move in our midst. Amen? If you don't come expecting anything, you're not going to get anything, right?
Yeah.
Well, you go to a candy store, if you're going to buy some candy, you want good candy, right? You don't want no sour candy. So when you come into God's house to hear God's word, you want to hear the truth, amen?
Yeah.
You want to hear that Jesus Christ is preached and lifted up, amen? Because
yeah.
Listen, when he is lifted up, all men be drawn nigh. That's where our whole life is in Jesus Christ. Amen?
Right.
Listen, that ain't got nothing to do with a message, so that's a freebie. Amen? That's a little golden nugget I want to share with you. Now, before I get to the message, you know, humor is a good thing. And so, this is from the desk of our pastor, Jim Palmer, a wonderful man, a great godly man. But I want to share a little quick story. I'm reading from this, and you hopefully you'll get a little humor, a little chuckle out of this, okay? The story is told of a new pastor who visited a nursing home to see Sister Elsa. You know, Sister Elsa was just a sweet old lady, wasn't she? He goes to her room, to the oldest lady in the church. As he talked with her, he reached over and would take a few peanuts from a bowl on her nightstand. Let me ask you a question before I go any further. Does any of you have peanuts on your nightstand? Okay, you're listening now, right? You listen. Here's the rest of the story. So, this is really humorous. I hope you get a good laugh out of this. Before the pastor realized it, he had eaten the entire bowl of peanuts. He was hungry. He emptied the container. As he prepared to leave, he apologized to Sister Elsa and told her he would bring her a new jar of peanuts on his next visit. That was very admirable of him, wasn't it? Very, very nice of him to say that. Sister Elsa laughed and said, "Pastor, don't you get it? All worked up about eating my peanuts. I don't really like peanuts. I just like to suck the salt off of them before I put them in the drink." So the reason I asked earlier, did anybody have any peanuts on their nightstand? There was a reason for that. Amen? So you get the moral of the story? Be careful what you eat. Amen? Especially going to somebody's room like that. So that's just a little wisdom, a little golden nugget, as they say, right? So, you know, before I get to my message, you know, there's a, if you go to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, there's a time for everything, right?
Yes.
There's a time for laughter, a time to cry, a time to mourn, and there's still a time to be serious.
Mm-hmm.
Now listen, this is a very serious service as we partake of the Lord's Supper later on. But it's a service where we have to look at ourselves, self-examination, and look at our lives.
Amen.
Amen? And first of all, be reminded what Christ did for us. He went to the cross for our sins. Amen? There's a time to laugh, a time to cry. Go to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. Read that. The time to mourn, time to laugh, and then also there's a time to be serious. And this is one of those times we need to be serious. So before we do, let's get into God. Let's go ahead and let's pray again, okay? I want to pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we come before your presence this day. We invite the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit in this place. Thank you for the laughter, for the joy, for the humor. But then thank you for the seriousness. Thank you, Lord, that you love us in spite of our faults, our frailties, our failures. You love us. You died on the cross for our sins. And we have to observe you in the Lord's Supper. We are to be reminded of what you did for each one of us. Lord, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you that when we call upon you, you are never too busy to hear our prayers. Oh, Holy Spirit, come in this place right now with your presence, because we desire the Holy Spirit's presence in this place today. We want your presence, Lord. You are honored guest. We thank you for joining us today, because, Lord, without you, we don't need to be here. We desire to be in your presence. As we open up your word, may your Holy Spirit speak to us today. May you encourage us today. And may we all be reminded of what you did for us, Father. Thank you again for your love, for your grace, for your patience, for your mercy, your unending mercy. Thank you for our salvation. Thank you for the promises in your word. Thank you, Lord, that one day, once we know you as Lord and Savior, we will be in heaven for eternity. Father, again, we invite your presence to stay in this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Dr. Steve, he's wanting to go down on me.
Yeah.
Yeah, we could have that far down there. It's a long way down there.
you had it kind of fixed and then it kind of not fixed.
Well, I think I popped my big feet on, my size 12 foot on there. So, message this morning, or this afternoon, as many names you can give it, but I'm going to call it self-examination. Self-examination. As we look in the scripture, as we prepare to partake the Lord's Supper. Now, by partaking the Lord's Supper, first of all, we need to be reminded of the great love He has for us. Amen? Can you say that? Jesus loves you. Amen?
He loves me.
Can you say that? Jesus loves me. He died for me. Right? He loves us unconditionally. And there's nothing we can do to deserve that love. He did it because He is God. And that's why He came to this earth. Because He loved us. Amen? So, the Lord's Supper is an act of worship. Now, if you go into Scripture, if you look in Scripture, it's recorded in three of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And then when I went a little further on, I went into 1 Corinthians, what Paul wrote. And that's my main scripture I'm going to come out of, because it gets a little deeper into it. But I want to go into 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And I'm going to, before I begin to read, I'm just going to kind of give you a little background about what's happening during this time. So, Paul recorded the importance of the Lord's Supper. But also, what does he do? He gives words of warning. He gives words of warning not to blaspheme the Lord's Supper. Yes. See, the church of Corinth was having many difficulties. Part of their difficulties, they would gather together for their meals, the large meals, and they call it, if you look in the study, it's called the love feast, where they would get together and have a big dinner. Time for fellowship, time of joy, time of laughter, time of cutting up. It was a social gathering, and they just wanted to encourage each other and love each other. But what happened when they finished the meal, when they got to the partaking of the Lord's Supper, they really forgot the true meaning of what the Lord's Supper stood for. So Paul was encouraging the church, trying to get them back on course. You see? But how many churches today that don't even partake of the Lord's Supper? I'm sure a lot. Mm-hmm. How many people just consider the Lord's Supper a ritual? Paul, let me tell you, people, it is not a ritual. Amen? Yeah. It is something precious to the Lord. He commands us to do it. If it's precious to my Lord, my Savior, it's going to be precious to you and I. Amen? Yeah. You see, it's something to take serious. But the people in Corinth didn't take it serious. As they would gather these meals, they have these large meals at these wealthy people's homes, the poor people would come in, they would eat, they'd be eating last. And so by the time they got finished their meals, they were having a full stomach, when they got ready to partake of the Lord's Supper, they just really kind of forgot about what it really truly meant. And Paul, as bold as he was, what did he do? He reminded them very emphatically, this is wrong what you're doing. He wanted to set the record straight. He taught them differently, but they went and chose their own way. The Lord's Supper is not a ritual. It's just not another service. It's a very special service that we need to honor Him with. Amen? Mm-hmm. It's a service where we need to look at our life and look at our hearts and our minds and say, okay, Lord, I thank You that You died on the cross for me. And His Word says that we need to do this in remembrance of Him. Amen? Yeah. In remembrance of Him. See, without His birth, I said this before, without His birth, there would have been no death. Amen? Without His death, there would have been no resurrection. Amen? Without the resurrection, there would have been no hope. Amen? So see, that's how we can worship Jesus. We can celebrate Easter. Right? Because He's risen. Amen? See, there's no commandments in Scripture that I know of that says we have to worship Him on His birthday, is there? But we have to worship Him and honor Him on His death day. When He died on the cross for us. Amen?
Amen.
So, they would gather together. I said earlier, they would eat last, before would eat last. And they didn't take seriously what Paul had taught. It just became another ritual. Churches today do the same thing. Stay for another day, another service. Just to come to church, hear a message, and go home. The sad thing about when you go into a church and you hear a message, when you leave that church, that message ought to change your life. Amen? It ought to change your life. It ought to convict you of your sins. It ought to It'll remind you what the Lord did for you. Amen? A lot of times you're just going to church, it's another service. The Lord's Supper is just not another service. But where's Scripture that we talk about the birth of Christ so much, but we focus on the death of Christ, what He did for us? He said to do this in remembrance of me. Here, Paul gives clear revelation in verse 23. And I'm going to read verse 23, what it says. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the same night as He was betrayed, took bread. So here Paul, in verse 23, he had clear revelation from God. He had a clear message from God what he was supposed to do. Paul was very bold, wasn't he? The one thing about Paul is obedient. And when he was given a message, what would he do? He followed through.
Amen.
The problem is a lot of times God gives us a message or gives us something to say or gives us a word. What do we do? We don't always follow through. But Paul was very bold, very emphatic. And God gave him a message. He told him what to do and to follow through with it. And then it says in verse 27 and 28, we examine ourselves here. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. So verse 28, so let's go back to 27. When we partake and come with unrepentant sin, we dishonor this special ceremony, don't we?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. When we come before Christ to observe the Lord's Supper, first of all, we have to get real with God, don't we? We have to repent of our sins. We have to let go of that anger, that bitterness, that hate, whatever we might have in our heart, and say, Lord, forgive me. I am a sinner, and I ask you to take this from me. Repent of your sins. Confess your sins. Amen? You know, get the slate clean. Amen? We need to look at ourselves. We cannot hold on to bitterness and ungodly attitudes. Does anybody have ungodly attitudes? Don't raise your hands. Or this is not confession time. Amen? Do you hate your brother or your sister? Are you holding a grudge? You know what breaks my heart is in my own family, seeing issues where they don't want to talk to each other. It breaks my heart. Amen? And so many families are dealing with those kind of issues. But we just can't hold on to bitterness. We have to forgive. Amen? Forgive. Forgiveness sometimes is difficult. You see, when we dishonor God, if we take this communion, we're sin in our lives. Amen? You've got to get the slate clean. You've got to repent. Ask Him to forgive you. The way I like looking at it is you've got to look in the mirror at yourself. You see? Look behind all the makeup and all the other things that we put on. Or the smiling face. And look at your mind. Look at your face. And look at your heart. And say, Lord, if there is any sin in my life that I need to confess, I confess it to you. I'm a sinner saved only by God's grace and mercy. Amen? We are all sinners. But what's amazing about that is He still loves you and I. Amen? Like when Keith was saying, even when we are unfaithful, He is always, always, always faithful. Amen?
Right.
Isn't that right?
Yeah.
Even when we mess up, I don't care what age we are, how bad we messed up, He still loves us. Amen?
Yeah.
Man, that's why His blood covers all of our sins. Amen? Not just some of our sins, but all of our sins. And thank God we're all equal at the cross. We're all sinners in need of a Savior. Amen?
Amen.
So, verse 28 says here, and listen very carefully, but let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. I said earlier, look into the mirror. Look into the mirror. I'm a sinner, saved only by God's grace and His mercy. Why did Jesus come to the earth? Why did He come? For one thing. To teach us to live and to die for you and I. That one day we can get to heaven. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus is our advocate. Amen? He's our advocate. The only way to get to cross that bridge from here to God is through who? Through Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man comes to the Father. That's why I made John 14:6. Amen?
Yes.
And there's no other way but through Jesus Christ. I don't care what the world says, and the world says everything else, but there's not but one way to heaven, that's through Jesus Christ. So, He went to that cross, He died for all of our sins. So once we do this self-examination and we get real with God, then we can partake of the Lord's Supper. Isn't that right? Once we look at ourselves and realize how bad we mess up, that we confess His faithful and just to forgive us of our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen? All unrighteousness. Look in the mirror and say, Lord, I am a sinner. Lord, I confess my sins before you. Let me tell you one thing. When I get on my knees and start talking to the Lord, sometimes I just want to cry because He loves me that much. You know, I love my children, my grandchildren so much. I'd do anything in the world for them. I will always love them no matter what they do to me. And how much greater is the love of God toward us. Amen? That we sin all the time. From the time we're birthed, the time the Lord calls us home. And in my life, that's a lot of sin. Amen? I mess up a lot. But I confess my sin. That's it. Lord, I'm a sinner. Forgive me. I'm a sinner. You just got to get real with God. Amen? Amen? Get real with God. Make sure of your salvation. You cannot partake of the Lord's Supper unless you know Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. Don't play games with God. He knows your heart. Amen? Yeah. He wants to save you. But please, please, I beg of you to make sure of your salvation. You got to know that you know that you know of your salvation. Amen? Yeah. Before you can partake of the Lord's Supper. Because it says here, if you don't, you're blaspheming against God. You're blaspheming against God. Let's go look for a little further on the Scripture. I say, you know, when the Holy Spirit speaks, listen to me. There's been some services I've been at, I've cried like a baby. But I'm going to tell you one thing. I can't help it because the love of God that flows in me and through me, that He loves me that much. If you can't get a preacher down in front of you and cry, then you need to look at that preacher. Amen? There's nothing wrong with crying. Amen? I'm a grown man, but I'm saying, well, I can bawl like a baby. I can bawl the best of them. Amen? Can y'all relate?
Oh, yeah.
I can bawl the best of them. After you run them eyes, my eyes all full and puffed up and everything else. But I'm going to tell you one thing. You know, when you cry, you get real before God. And guess what? When you finish, you say, okay, Lord, thank you for helping me to confess my sins, to forgive me of my sins. It's like a cleansing, like a washing. Amen?
Yeah.
It's like taking a good shower, a spiritual shower. When you just get real with God, you just pour yourself out to Him. And then when you pour yourself out and get that stuff out of you, guess what happens? The Holy Spirit comes in and He fills you back up. Amen?
Yeah.
Isn't that right? Pray that that don't get, listen, that don't get you excited, nothing's going to get you excited. Amen? Right. Praise the Lord. You know, listen, we serve a great God. Amen? We serve a wonderful God, a merciful God, a loving God. But also we serve a God that will punish sin. That will punish sin. We have to get real with God. So, verse 29 says here, for he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep, or many are dead. You see, verse 29 says, we take this, the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner, and it brings judgment to ourselves. When we take it in an unworthy manner, we treat His life, Jesus' life, and the suffering and death is just menial. Just another story.
Right.
It's not another story.
Amen.
It's a life-changing message of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Yeah.
The life-changing, hear what I said? The life-changing message of Jesus Christ. Amen? Isn't that right? Is that right? Can you say amen?
Amen.
Well, praise the Lord. Nobody's sleeping on me, are you? I tell you what, sometimes when I see people starting to want to nod off about, I say, hey, does anybody have an apple? And nobody ever raised their hand beside us. You got an apple? Please don't throw it at me. And if you're going to do, please let me know it's coming so I can get out of the way so I don't get hit. So, verse 30 says, the ones who blaspheme God, many are sick and weak and even dead. The worst offenders even taken to death. So, this service is something you take very, very seriously. Amen?
Yeah.
You take it seriously. You have to get the slate clean. Make the slate clean. Confess, repent, turn away. Look in the mirror and say, okay, Lord, I confess, I repent of all my sins before partaking of the Lord's Supper. as we begin to prepare for partaking here very shortly, first of all, I want to encourage you. This is a serious time for you and God to get things straight. Amen? A serious time. We need to approach this service with love, humility, confession, and self-examination. If there is any sin in your life, unconfessed sin, do not, listen to me, do not partake. Amen? If you are not a Christian today, if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, do not partake of the Lord's Supper. Amen? Don't do it. First of all, you have to be a child of God, born again by the blood of Christ. Confess your sins. And may I remind you that He loves you, He died for you, He is our advocate, and His blood covers all of our sins. So what we're going to do right now, before we go to the little, any further, I think we're going to sing a song. Is that right, Charles? We're going to sing a song. Charles will hand out the condiments. At the very end of the service, we'll open up the condiments and proceed with the Lord's Supper. So before we do that, let's take this time to close our eyes and just pray. Just have a few moments of silence and just, you do business with God. Amen? Just close your eyes, repent of your sins, confess your sins, and ask God to forgive you. Just give a few moments of silence. Dear Father, as we come before your presence again, as we begin to sing this song, and as we soon partake of the Lord's Supper, Father, we pray for forgiveness of our sins, for cleansing us from all unrighteousness. We repent of our sins, Father. And Lord, by this, Father, our sins are forgiven by the blood of Christ. So, Father, may you be glorified in this service, Father. As we continue on in Jesus' name, amen.
You can take your hymn books. Turn to hymn 555. 555. Let's just sing this chorus. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice.
Thank you.
I'll start passing out the elements and we'll begin. Come to this table not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because any goodness of your own gives you a right to come, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little and would love to love Him more. Come because you loved Him, He loved you, and gave Himself for you. Come and meet the risen Christ, for we are His body. And now I'd like to pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open and all desires known, from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts and forgive us all of our transgressions. Prepare us, Lord, to receive Your holy sacrament by the inspiration of Your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love You. May we walk with You in obedience and worthily magnify Your holy name. Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And one more prayer. Our loving God and Heavenly Father, we praise and thank You for the grace and for Your love that You've shown to us and the sacrifice for Your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. We thank You for His life and ministry, announcing the good news of Your kingdom and the new covenant of grace for all who believe in Him, who came down from His throne in heaven to demonstrate the power of His kingdom and the lifting of the downtrodden, the healing of the sick, and the loving of the loveless. We thank You for this sacrificial death upon the cross, providing the only acceptable sacrifice that could become justification for the redemption of the world, and for Your raising Him again to life on the third day, defeating death once and for all as a foretaste of the glory we shall all share. We give You thanks for this bread and wine, symbols of our Savior's sacrifice for our sins, and signs for Your transforming love. Fill each of us today with Your Holy Spirit, we pray, that we may be sanctified into the likeness of Jesus Christ and formed as a church into His unified body. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Your kingdom come, Your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are Yours, now and forever. This we pray in the name of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
on. Once everyone has it open, if you just look toward me. All right, everyone have it open?
Not yet.
Not yet. Yeah. Thanks a little finesse opening things up, doesn't it? Before COVID, if everyone remembers, we used to put the bread and the plate and the waitress, and we passed it around. Remember, then we did the same thing with the wine. Remember that? When COVID came in, we couldn't go there, so we had to improvise. You know what I'm saying? And so this is our improvisation, I guess. So I think we're all ready. So in Matthew 26, verse 26, here's what it says. And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body." Yes, thank you, Lord. Then as you open up for the wine, very carefully. Once everyone has it open, you can look toward me. Everyone ready?
No.
No, okay. Okay, next scriptures. Matthew 26, verses 27, 28. Then he took the cup, he gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." And then what does Scripture say at the conclusion of the Lord's Supper? What they do? They walked away and they sang, didn't they? Yes. Keep what they sing, you know?
I have no idea.
Well, can you
maybe sing? Amazing Grace.
Well, let's sing some. Let's do Amazing Grace and close up the service. Amen?
All right, if you need your hymn book, hymn 104, I'll give you time to get there. I'm too quick sometimes. Hymn 104. Everybody get that number? And we'll do the first and last verse of hymn 104.
Thank you.
Awesome, everyone. Thank you so much. Such a wonderful service. Thank you for sharing that together with each other. I will do our final prayer and our prayer request as we normally do, and then we'll end our service. Any updates or changes to the prayer request that we need to... Yes?
I have to say, the last message I got from my daughter Linda with Tom with that cancer is that it's now in the bone and in the skull, and that's very scary.
Yeah.
And my son Richard, right, well, he's falling and he's getting worse mentally, but they are going on a trip, which he's so looking forward to.
Galapagos, right?
The Galapagos, yeah. So I'm so happy that they could do that.
Yeah, that's awesome, and I hope he has a great time. I'm sure he will. I'm sure he will. That'll be nice. Is Tom seeing any new doctors or?
Well, he just went to the oncologist, dermatologist, surgeon,
right,
who tried to get the rest of the cancer off the top of his head.
Right.
But it's now in the bone, so that is very, very serious. I mean, that's my common state, and it's just a matter of time. But we just pray that the Lord will grant them the grace and mercy and strength to go through this hard time.
Yes. Are they going to do any kind of radiation?
I know I could hear, and Linda didn't want to talk about it.
Sure.
So
that can be difficult.
I don't know.
But we'll give it to God.
Thank you.
And he is the master of all.
Thank you. And a good report for Carol Alder. She's doing better. She's been transferred to the Dry Sidewood Rehab Center.
Right.
And they've gotten her up to get out of bed.
Awesome.
But in the wheelchair, she's had physical therapy and occupational therapy, but she has quite a bit of pain and this great swelling on her right side with the fluid. Her legs are better, the blood pressure's better.
Good.
So that's wonderful.
Very good. I'll call her this week then too.
Wonderful. Yeah, she would enjoy it all. Yeah. Today she said it's her day off.
That's good. I'm glad to hear that's good praise. Any other requests or additions? Or?
Yeah, my friend, Carol Tracy and her daughter, her daughter is just simply bowed down there. I don't think she's taken one little step forward because of
it. Right.
And Carol is trying desperately, you know, but things happen, they just knock you down. Things you don't expect just put you right back in that awful spot where she was.
Sure.
It just happened. So please just continue to pray for them to say they need us for it.
Right. Okay, I'm putting that in here. Right. Any other additions or updates? No? Any new prayers that we want to add to the prayer list? Anything we should take off of the prayer list? Yes?
Go ahead, take mine off. Okay. I'm too well. Being trained for more recovery.
Beautiful. Mm-hmm. I love hearing that. That's awesome. That's I have to keep you on one last time for a phrase that you want to be taken off.
Okay.
Fair enough?
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
That's awesome. And has anybody heard about Muriel? I'm looking at you. How's your vision doing? Is it still good?
I'm getting my fourth eye shot on Tuesday.
Uh-huh.
And the first three have reduced the scope of the blindness.
Good.
So we're making progress.
So still continuing to work.
God's good.
Awesome.
Yeah. Right, sure is.
All right, so I'm going to put continuing to improve. good to hear. Has anybody heard anything from Leisha or about Leisha and her vision issues?
No, she was in the hospital over the last hospital.
Was she? Okay.
She may still be there.
Okay, so we'll pray. We'll pray about that as well. Then, Linda Worley. Any word on Linda Worley?
Linda's cancer, thank God, went well, and they removed the cyst on her head. They're waiting to see what the biopsy will prove, but she feels sure they were benign.
Okay.
And her face was so well. She had the sutures removed, so that's good. But of course, it's a hard time for both of them, Tom and Linda.
So I'll put down additional prayer for recovery for her as well. Lynn, any word about Lynn that fell from her chair last week? I heard she fell from her chair. How's she doing? Lynn, I'm sorry.
L-E-N.
L-E-N. Okay, let me change the spelling. That'll help me see that I've got the So how is Lynn? How is he doing?
He's back. He needs to be good.
Okay, so he's okay. All right. So I'm going to remove him then. And Carol, we just talked about Nathan. Any word on Nathan and his stomach issues? And
he's still the same.
Is he? Okay, yeah. So continue to pray?
Yeah, continue to pray.
Any word on Vivian and her leg pain?
I haven't prayed.
Yes.
I know my church has been praying and they're super healed on the end. But I walk with the walker for the first time.
Yes. Awesome.
It's really getting better and hurting.
Good.
Amen.
Well, do me a favor, please, and I'm sorry to ask, but remind me the name.
But?
Remind me the name.
What is that?
Which remind you of your name.
Oh, Hazel.
Hazel.
Hazel Carl.
I've got you on here, Hazel, yes.
That Carl with the door name.
Okay. I just couldn't remember your name, my dear. I'm sorry. So we put praise that you're beginning to use the offer. And it's working. Awesome. That's excellent. Any word on Adam, Sean, and the Daniel family? No. What about Kate Pierce, who had a broken pelvis in two places?
Kate?
Yes.
Is in the hospital. She fell and broke her pelvis in two places.
Right.
But she's going home this week.
Oh, good. So she's doing better.
She's been in the hospital a month.
Right. Wow. So good. Okay. Well, good. So we can praise headed home. Okay. And Dorothy, any word on Dorothy who I had word is following as well?
She's been at dinner the last couple of nights.
Oh, well then praise she's back to dinner. Okay. Samuel and the surgery and all that, how on his elbow, how's he doing? Any word on Samuel and his surgery? No? Okay. Annika, I know who normally asks, she's not here, so we just continue to pray and praise for her. Dawn, who hurt her back? Any word on Dawn? What about Christy with vertigo. Any word on Christy?
She's almost there.
Okay, still kind of at the edge.
No, not even close. 5% is even too much. She's more.
And so? Okay, wow.
Yeah.
So last I heard was 20, so that's continuing the improvement. Awesome. All right. Good. What about Charlie, his passing and all that? Should we continue to pray for the family for that? What about Henry, any word on Henry? The Henry that does Sunday school here. Any word on Henry?
Still getting therapy.
Okay.
But he's much, much better.
Oh, is he? doing it good. All right, and what about Pat in England and Bridget from cancer? Pat in England and Bridget. And Bethany, Bethany that we have had word had heart problems.
Yes, she's doing
better. Is she doing better? Okay. Continue to keep her on the list, or should we take her off?
I think you can take her.
Okay. And what about Deborah Mock, who has edema and health issues? And any word on Deborah Mock? No? We'll just keep her on the list then. Donna, how are you doing with
I'm doing, I just praise the Lord because it's so much better. It's unreal to know that it's almost back to normal, and I'll accept it for however it is, and thank God for it.
Yeah. You, that's a praise. That's awesome.
She's ready for Easter.
Yes. Butch, you had COPD, any word on Butch?
Yes, he's still doing that.
Still have COPD or?
Yes,
still. And still the problems and all that? Yeah. Okay, and Sabrina, any word on Sabrina and how she's doing with the new baby and all that? No, I'm going to take her off the list because last I heard things were going really well. Long, how you doing, brother? How's everything with your health? Because you're on a list too, you know that, right?
Yeah, praise the Lord. I go back in June to get my blood test, so I'll let God have to take care of it.
All right. So we're going to pray for good results in June.
I heard if Ron behaved, he'd be okay.
If I behave, well, praise the Lord. If y'all behave, I'd be okay.
And how's your mom doing?
Mom's not doing well. No, she's not doing well at all.
We'll continue to pray for her. And Caroline and Andrew and Chad Bigelow, any word on their business? Andrew, Chad Bigelow.
They're 12
years old.
They're still
not
where they
love to
be, but
it's
stable.
Should we keep them on the list or no?
It's okay.
Okay, take them off. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Well, that kind of updates everything then. All right. Let's bow our heads and we will begin our final prayer for the service. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, Lord, as you serve us. Father, thank you so much for such a beautiful service. Thank you for letting me be part of it. Thank you, Father, for giving me an opportunity to share share in this wonderful knowledge and worship of you, Father. Thank you for the opportunity to be with fellow Christians as we remember what you did for us, each and every one of us on the cross. That Father, that you went there for us to save us, not for your own sake, for our sake, and not for any other reason than because you love us. Not love that we deserve, not love that we earn, not love that we even appreciate most of the time, but love that you just have for us by grace and kindness that, Father, we only wish we could understand, and only wish that we could possess. Father, we ask that you would help us see that grace, see it fully, and appreciate it fully. Father, we thank you for the chance each and every day to worship you again. We thank you for the opportunity to love you with all of our heart. We thank you, Father, for the chance to share in that love and share in that fellowship with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. We thank you, Lord, for all you do each and every day in our lives. We thank you, Father, even for those things that we sometimes are upset about, that we don't know why. Father, those are the things that I find are the most profound lessons that I learned, are the ones that I one day ask why, the next day I ask why not. Thank you for that, Father. Thank you for teaching me those things I need to learn, rather than just the things I want to learn. Thank you, Father, for the love that you share with me each and every day. Thank you for the pulpit that I know that I can come to no matter where I'm at. Thank you for your love. Father, I come before you today with many on our prayer list. And Father, I ask that you would share your grace and love with each and every one. That Father, you would be in every one of their lives. That Lord, you would shape them and mold them. And make them be the person that you want them to be. That Father, you would show them the path to righteousness. That Lord, you would show them the two paths and that they would choose the right one rather than the left one. Father, I thank you for all of these people and all of the things that you do in their life. And Father, I ask that you would continue to be part of their life. That Lord, you would continue to show them the path to you. And Father, that you would grow in their love and in their honor of you. Father, I hold up to you Richard, who has Parkinson's. And I ask first and foremost for his salvation. Father, I know that the condition he has is degenerative. And I know that he is going through so many things right now. Father, I ask that you would give him a good time on his trip. That, Lord, you would show him the power of prayer. That the power of fervent prayer, Father. That you would show him that you're there. And you've always been there. Always been there. Even when he didn't know it or didn't care to look. And Father, I ask that he would begin to see you in every aspect of his life. That Father, he would finally break down and understand that he's a Christian hiding from his father. That he's the little boy in the corner that's done wrong and knows it. Show him the truth, Father. Help him see your love. Bring him back to your grace. Lord, I hold up to you Tom, who has carcinoma, and we just learned today that it has moved to the bones in his skull. And Father, I ask that you would be with him. That Lord, you would strengthen him through this hard time. That Father, that you would allow this to propel his faith forward. That it would help him love you more. That it would increase his faith in you. That it would not damage his relationship with you, Father, but would perfect his relationship with you. Lord, I ask that through this condition that he has, that he would find perfect faith in you. And that, Lord, that you would have your way in his life. And Father, if it's your will to heal him, Lord, I ask that to be the case. That if you wish to show him the power of prayer, the power of a God that can do anything, Lord, if you want to show him a miracle like you showed me with my daughter, I ask that you do that. And you do it in such a bold way that just like the Israelites could not say anything but this was God, that Tom would say, this was God. God healed him. Father, I ask that you would do that for him. Lord, I hold up to you Linda Worley for prayer and ask for her recovery. And our continued recovery. Father, I hold up to you Cheryl Tracy and Kendra for the loss of Isaac and Jay. And I ask, Father, that you would help them to begin to process this loss. And let them see that it's not a true loss, Father, that they've just gone to another place. And that, Lord, that they're there waiting and that they can be seen again. Father, help them to see that. Help them to accept your will. And Father, help them to come to grips and come to acceptance of this. And be able to move forward so that they can in turn continue to grow as a Christian and continue to do your work, Father. Lord, I hold up to you Leisha, who has issues and pain in her eyes and blurry vision, and she just learned is in the hospital. Father, I ask that you would continue to be with her, that you would continue to work in her life, that, Lord, you would help her to continue to find doctors that can give her answers, that they would have discernment, and, Father, that they would be able to give her a path forward instead of stagnation. And, Father, I ask that through all of this, that she would see that she has you above all, and that, Lord, no matter what happens with her health, She's the daughter of the king. And who can be sad when they're the daughter of the king? Father, I hold up to you, Carol Allgood, in praise. And I thank you so much, Father, for showing her the power of prayer. For bringing her through a surgery that men told her she would not make it through. That she was going to die. Father, thank you for showing her that you make that decision. No man. No man does. No man has the power to do that. And that, Father, until you're done, she's here. Thank you for showing her that, Lord. Thank you for giving her confidence in you. Renewing her confidence in you. Not giving it. Renewing her faith. Thank you for strengthening her faith. Father, I hold up to you, Nathan, who's continuing to have stomach issues and losing weight. And I ask, Father, that you be in his life, that you would help him with this affliction. That, Father, you would feed him with not only the bread of your word, but the bread of sustenance, so that he might get better and be more attentive to you. Father, I hold up to you, Vivian, who has leg pain. I hold up to you, Adam, Sean, and Michael, and the Daniel family for their loss. I hold up to you, Kate Pierce, who's broken her pelvis in two places, and asked if she would continue to heal them. She's heading home now, and that she would continue to have good reports from her doctor, that she might be done with all of the pain, be done with all of the therapy. Father, I hold up to you that you would continue to work in her life, continue to be the most important thing in her life, and show her the power of you as Jehovah Rapha, the ultimate physician. Lord, I hold up to you, Hazel, and praise you, Lord, for the fact that you helped her get into her walker and be able to continue to use it. And Lord, I ask that you would continue to strengthen her legs, continue to strengthen her arms, and give her more opportunities to walk. But Lord, most importantly, I ask that you walk with her spiritually. That, Father, her walk with you might become perfected. That, Father, that she might find that through all of it, that this has brought her closer to you. Lord, I hold up to you Dorothy, who's fallen. And I praise you that she's back to dinner service and continuing to do better. And that, Father, I ask that she continues to heal and become better each day. Father, I hold up to you, Sammy, who had surgery on his elbow. And I thank you for that successful surgery and ask that you continue to help him heal. Father, I hold up to you, Annika, and ask for continued help with her. That, Lord, you would continue to strengthen her faith in her, in you. And that, Lord, you would continue to take away the thoughts in her mind that she's not good enough, that she's not pretty enough, that she's not whatever that the world wants her to believe she's not enough of. Father, show her the beauty that she is. Remind her the beauty that she has. Because she's a Christian. And she's a light and a beacon of you. And Father, there is nothing more beautiful. Nothing more beautiful. Lord, I hold up to you, Christy with vertigo. And thank you that her vertigo is continuing to go away. Father, I hold up to you, Muriel. And thank you for her continuing vision. That I ask that these shots continue to remove the blockage from her sight. And Father, I thank you that you've given her increased sight in you and an increased faith in you. Father, I know your faith, or her faith in you has increased. I've seen it. And I thank you for that. Lord, I hold up to you, Charlie, who in his passing. And I hold up to you their family and ask that you continue to comfort them. Father, I hold up to you, Henry, with his collarbone and fall that he had, the broken collarbone, and the bladder issues that he's having because of the fall. And Father, I thank you that I'm hearing that he's continuing to improve, and I ask that that continue to be the case. Father, I hold up to you, Lori Fitzgerald, who passed, and I ask that you continue to comfort her husband, Adam. Father, I hold up to you, Roy and Jim, and their friends and family. Father, I hold up to you, Pat and England and Bridget, who have cancer, and ask that you continue to work in their health and life. Father, I hold up to you, Deborah Mock, and ask that the edema and issues with pain that she has, that, Lord, you would work in her life and continue to help her heal. Father, I hold up to you, Donna, and thank you and praise that her lungs are nearly back to what they were. And Father, I thank you so much. And thank you so much for her being here with me and helping me in all that we do. Thank you so much, Father, for Donna, and I praise you so many ways for giving her back the lungs and the breath in her chest. Father, I ask that that you continue to do so, that you continue to keep her here with me as a servant of you. Father, I hold up to you Butch and ask that you would continue to help him heal from the COPD. Father, I hold up to you Terry and one half time and thank you and praise you that you've given her back her vision. And Father, even though I'm taking her off this prayer list, she'll always be in my thoughts, always be in my prayers, always have my love and your love. Father, I hold up to you on here, and I pray that he gets good results from his blood test that's coming in June. And Father, I ask that you would continue to strengthen him, continue to keep his cancer at bay, that Father, you would continue to allow him to be of service here for you, that Father, I need his help, and I ask that you would continue to give him in service as well as you've done Don, as a favor to me. Father, I hold up to you his mom, Caroline, and ask that you would continue to also work in her life, and Father, have your will in her life done. Father, I hold up to you all of these people, all of these situations, all of these issues, all of these health problems, and all of these praises. And Father, I hold them up to you in love. And Lord, I thank you so much for the opportunity just to pray to you about these things. I thank you for the privilege and the honor that I have to be able to bring others to you in prayer and know that you listen to me. To me. Thank you for that, Father. Lord, I ask that you do the best for all of these folks, that you show them the good in their life, that you would let each and every one of them become closer to you today, and that each and every one would become a better Christian and would serve you with all of their heart. Father, I thank you for all of these things and all of these people, and I hold them all up to you in your Son's precious name. In the name of my Lord, my Messiah, my Savior, I pray. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you all for a beautiful service. Thank you all for just being here. I love each and every one of you. Go and share that love with the rest of the world. It needs it. It needs each and every one of us to care about the world as much as we can. Do that. Do that this week. Share your love with someone else. God bless you all.
Thank you.
Bye, y'all. Y'all have a great week. God bless you. Thank y'all for coming, okay? Bye now.
We'll try and do the same.
I'm not working. I'm going to do the work with the international.